In this module 3 of evidence-based practice in language disability evaluations, we're going to look at language sample and elicitation and analysis in evidence-based practice. I'm Dr. Cate Crowley from Teachers College, Columbia University here in New York City. So why focus on language samples? Why? We found that many SLPs do not regularly use language sample elicitation and analysis in clinical practice. That's Pavelko et al. Found that. And why is there so little? Well, Nippold and Pavelko both found, one, students often receive little training in how to elicit and analyze language samples, and the way it's done tends to be very time-consuming. One great thing about language sample analysis is we can increase diagnostic accuracy. So if we move beyond MLUs and number of different words in our language sample analysis and into the structure of language, which I'll talk to you about more, and functional use of language, you'll be able to identify a true language disorder versus a child or student who may have exposure to a variety of English other than general American English, or a child or student who may have gaps in prior knowledge if you elicit the language sample in such a way that they can bring in their own values and cultures, which of course is part of the third leg of evidence-based practice. The school-age language assessment measures, the SLAM materials I created with Miriam Baigorri and now with another new colleague on, and the point is, the reason I did them is because we were trying to figure out how can we elicit language samples and gather language from kids who live in New York City or who not from particular backgrounds that are assumed in many of the omnibus language tests that may not never had a terrarium in their classroom or may never have been on a field day or may never have had talent shows in their school. How do we do that? What are some common experiences? So this is the school age language assessment measures. What we're trying to do is elicit in less cultural and linguistic biases. The SLAM materials were meant to engage students in a more natural way to elicit functional communication, functional language. There's an openness to the answers. There's no three correct answers. And students respond differently based on their backgrounds and interests, though that allows for the culture and values of the child, student, to be expressed. In a recent study of bilingual Jamaican Creole and English-speaking preschoolers, the authors found that the school-age language assessment measures, the SLAM, were a prominent example among a small number of assessments designed to minimize cultural and linguistic bias. So we were thrilled to read this by our friends and colleagues, Carla Washington, Carol Westby, and others. So how do we elicit a language sample? What does the research tell us about how to elicit a language sample? If you remember the Pavelko study, what they found is a lot of SLPs elicited language by conversation. Oh, what'd you do for the weekend? How many brothers and sisters do you have? Blah, blah, blah. I'll show you a little bit about that. So what Marilyn Nippold and her colleagues have found is that expository language is a good thing to elicit in a language sample, and I'll show you that word, that research. Expository means explain this to me. Some people still use a script, so how do you make a peanut butter sandwich? What do you do when you go to a birthday party? Which tends to be pretty formulaic and you tend to get a lot of simple sentences, or a simple sentence conjoined by an and, which makes it a compound sentence, but you're unlikely to get that complexity of syntax that you're looking for to stress the system. Persuasive language, Heilman, Malone, and Westervet all found that persuasive language was also very important. So trying to convince someone of a particular point of view. Fables, Nippold has found fables are useful in treatment. I haven't used them yet, but in the SLAM materials, we know, MA. So the benefits of eliciting expository language, Nippold and her colleagues looked at and found that expository language elicits more complex language. It demonstrates syntactic growth through early adulthood, and it differentiated between typically developing 13-year-olds and those with language impairment, while a conversational task did not. So the conversational task is not going to stress the linguistic system. So this weekend I went to the park, I was with my parents, we went to the mall. All these things are nice simple sentences, but they're not going to stress that system, as opposed to how did this happen? What would you do if this happened to you? What is the problem with a macro analysis in the narrative assessment to identify a disorder? So Burns et al. In 2012 told us that we really don't have a way of assessing narrative as a whole across cultures and languages. And there's a variety. So researchers advise using other methods to assess kids from backgrounds other than mainstream American English, other than saying, how is their narrative? Because narrative growth, narrative structures can be quite different across cultures. Burns, de Villiers, Pearson, and Champion, two of the authors of the Delve, wrote a very interesting article on dialect-neutral indices of narrative cohesion and evaluation. Now, they did elicit narratives, but what they did is they didn't look at the macro structure of the narrative. Rather, they looked at these micro structures. One, temporal cohesion and referential cohesion. Is that there? Do we understand time markers? Do we understand the narratives, who the child is referring to in the narrative? That's your referential cohesion. Next is theory of mind, taking perspectives, and false beliefs. So this is certainly more social pragmatic language. Can they take different perspectives, that flexibility to understand what's actually going on in a conversation? And we have seen that in these particular kinds of questions in the SLAM materials, kids with autism spectrum disorder or with social pragmatic language disorders have great difficulty in thinking of theory of mind, understanding theory of mind, taking perspectives, and understanding false beliefs. And then the last part is causal cohesion, how one connects to the other, cause and effect. Problem solving, making inferences, and making meaningful predictions. What do you think is going to happen next? When I developed the SLAM materials, they were developed consistent with evidence-based practice. We definitely used evidence from the research as to how to structure the SLAM cards, the SLAM materials, how to structure the elicitation. We use the clinician's own expertise, so it's not just me, it's not my co-authors. I also asked my friends and colleagues who are in the field to use the beta of whatever SLAM material I'm developing. Say, how does this work? Did this question work? There was a question in Bunny Goes to School, if you know that, and said, which boy did that? And I just got rid of it because it wasn't bringing any language out. It kind of seemed so artificial, it sort of stopped the nice free flow. So that took a little while for me to get, but so we bring clinicians, probably S apostrophe, own expertises to help us make sure this is going to be useful and valuable in the clinical setting. And then because there's no right answer, the values and culture of the family of the child student being evaluated can also be brought into it. And you'll see that in the videos that you're going to see in the next modules. So here are the SLAM materials, and I will actually show you them. We do have them translated into several languages already. Everything is available in Spanish. Everything is available in Mandarin. Then we also have everything available in French. And a lot is available in Bengali. We're working with people, my graduate students who speak other languages, to do some more translations of some of the questions so people can have them. But certainly, you can, if you speak other languages, you can download these, translate the questions, and use them. Because it's not a standardized test. You're not just translating a standardized test. These are just some questions that you can ask to elicit the language. So here's the subway. The subway was the very first material I ever used. It was when I started evaluating again 25 years ago, a couple more than that. And I was going around, how do I get these kids to talk to me? You know, I jump into a school. I couldn't get them to really like engage in the way that I wanted to. Certainly we could have conversations. So I found this picture. It was a photo in the back of a Life magazine. I modified it and asked Tina Young to illustrate it for me. So now we have this, and it's obviously a shoe stuck between two subway doors. Someone who works in Kingston, New York, who's in my institute now, she said, I tell them it's a door or it's an elevator, and it works. So, but other places, it's definitely made for New York City kids and for kids in other urban areas. This does not hurt the person because when a foot gets stuck, they pop open. Nobody has been damaged by a foot being there, and no child has been traumatized by looking at this. So what happened? How did this happen? So this expository language, did this ever happen to you? Looking for a personal narrative. What would you do if this happened to you? Again, making meaningful predictions. The crayons is the newest one. And the reason it's just since this summer, I think we posted it maybe in October. And the reason I wanted this, one of my former students, Kimberly Sundar, sent it to me. And she said, I think this might work. And I modified it. And then Tina actually illustrated it. And the idea is there's more perspective taking and there's more pragmatic social language in it. There's a lot of expository language. And there's a lot of persuasion often in the way kids respond. So I did have to work at it because initially I chose the colors I wanted and 10% of men are colorblind. So I got rid of those colors. And then there's a smaller group that are colorblind to other colors. So these colors should work for people who may have colorblindness too. You know, you have to think all kinds of things. Dog comes home. It's one of the two card sets that are for kids 4 years old through early elementary. So she sees the dog. She loves the dog. She remembers her mom says, theory of mine, no dogs in the house. She's going to sneak that dog in. Hopefully the mom won't know it's a dog. She gets home. The mom says, you are so dirty. Go in the bath. And the mom comes in and there's a white dog and a dirty girl, dirty, dirty bath water. And then that's just the last card. Here are the questions. You know, what would you say to your mom if you were the girl now? That's your persuasion. What is the mom going to do? Making meaningful predictions. Why is she in the bath with a white dog? Making inferences. Why is she getting so dirty? You'll see one little girl doing this. Bunny Goes to School is the other match set for four-year-olds through early elementary. Please remember this is a language elicitation task. It is not a sequencing task. So there is no harm in giving the first picture and then helping them get to the end. I have used these cards in the professional development that I do with professionals, SLPs, psychologists, educators. And I've never done it where several of the people don't quite get the sequence correctly. So please help the kids. I think that them moving the cards around really helps them feel some agency because they really get engaged in this, which makes me happy. For late elementary through high school, we have lost cell phone. He sees the girl. He gets chips. There's his phone. He gets a little distracted. He remembers he doesn't have his phone. He by looking at the girl and also checking his pockets, he remembers what he did with it. He goes rushing back to the store. And that's the last picture. So things like, did anything like this ever happen to you? And usually with the lost cell phone, people's got stories. What will happen when he goes back to the store? What does he think will happen? That's our theory of mind. What will happen? That's making meaningful predictions. It could be the same. What's he thinking here? What made him remember? So these are all questions, expository language, persuasive language, looking at the cohesion, temporal, referential. We're looking at theory of mind, taking perspectives, that social pragmatic language piece, false beliefs, and then the last part is the making meaningful predictions, making inferences, causal cohesion. So that's what all these questions are developed based on the research. Baseball troubles is the one other one late elementary through high school, and it's being blamed for something you didn't do. There also, I'm not going to talk about these today, but there's additional SLAM materials called Understanding Spoken Stories, where you read a story. And then the kids have to answer. They're for all ages, so they go from kindergarten through high school, but they get more complex in terms of what we're asking. Snow day is the teacher. It's a snow day. She hears in school, it's a snow day. The kids start high-fiving. There's a little boy from Florida who doesn't understand what's going on. And they say, why doesn't he understand? So there's a lot of nice inferences going on with snow day. And problems at Burger King is where a family's having a birthday party and the kids go to buy all the things for the birthday party at Burger King. Some things an aunt is bringing. And then they, of course, forget and remember everything but the wallet with the money on the kitchen table and what's going to happen. So those are things without the pictures to see if the kids can hold the language. So you can compare what they can do with pictures and then with how well they hold these stories. But we're not going to talk much about them. I just want to tell you those are there as well. Now I've introduced you to the SLAM materials. I've introduced you to the evidence-based practice of SLAM materials. And now we're going to actually look at the elicitation and analysis of language samples and evidence-based practice using the SLAM materials in the next module.